Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to everyone, both in the building and online. It's a good day to be together in the household of faith. Amen?
Amen.
If you're visiting with us this morning, please feel our welcome. There are black pads at the ends of the rows in the pews, and we invite you to just register your attendance so that we can get to know one another by name. And if you're joining us online, you can say hello in the comment sections or go to nwumc.com/connect and register your attendance there. I want to give you a heads up. I just want you to know that instead of the chorus or verse of O Come All Ye Faithful after the offering, we've changed that chorus to God Be the Glory. So just wanted to prepare you for that, and so you won't think it's a hiccup. Anyway, it is just good to be together. Our opening hymn is Jesus Calls Us, in body or in spirit. Stand and let's sing together.
Sign-up sheets are in the hall.
The Church for All People has opened its doors as a warming center to those needing shelter from the cold as of January 3rd. We are also collecting snack foods to share with our guests. Donations can be left at the church office. Your generosity is appreciated. And now we will hear an announcement from Pastor Chris.
Thank you, Tom. As Tom mentioned, for those who are visiting or watching for the first time online, I'm Pastor Chris, along with Pastor Mebane, the pastors here. It is that time when we are looking ahead to our mission trip. This year, we are going to go to Nashville, and the dates you can see there are June 25th through July 1st. We'll leave June 25th. We'll return July 1st. We're going with an organization called Be the Neighbor, and we'll be staying at a church there in Nashville that has hot water, showers, and a kitchen. And the focus for this summer's mission trip is homelessness and housing justice. So people always ask me, what are we going to be doing? I don't know. They usually tell me about 2 weeks beforehand the exact project that we'll be doing. But usually there is construction involved. You do not need to be Randy Brewer in order to go. But they will train you. But they also will be doing some work with us around homelessness and housing justice and the ways that the legal codes in Nashville impact that and some of the resources that city has. And then will train us and equip us to bring that knowledge back here to our hometown, to Columbus, so that hopefully we can continue to sustain and do that work here. So the trip is open to all people, 10 and up. Okay? If you are a fifth grader, if you are 10, we ask that a parent come along with you. All right. But other than that, you are welcome to come. You do not have to have a child in the youth group to come. Please come. If you are an adult, you are welcome as well. Please see me after the service if you think you might like to come on the mission trip. It's a $50 deposit. We all drive down together. The cost is $325 a person, but as you have seen, we do fundraisers throughout the spring to help offset that cost. So please see me after the service if you think you might want to go on mission trip, and we'll plug you right into the sub-sale so you can start working on that. Thank you. Now let's continue with our worship.
Children,
122 people into three groups, and two of the groups were assigned to techniques often used in cognitive behavioral therapy for depression, planning social activities, or cognitive reappraisal, which is identifying negative thought patterns and then revising your thoughts. Members of the third group were instructed to perform three acts of kindness a day for 2 days out of the week. Participants followed their instructions for 10 weeks, and the findings showed that participants in all three groups showed an increase in life satisfaction and a reduction of depression and anxiety symptoms. However, the group performing acts of kindness led to improvements not seen in the other two groups. The acts of kindness technique was the only intervention tested that helped people feel more connected to others. In addition, the acts of kindness group showed greater improvements than the cognitive reappraisal group for life satisfaction and symptoms of depression and anxiety. There's something specific about performing acts of kindness that makes people feel connected to others. It's not enough to just be around other people participating in social activities, said co-author Jennifer Chevens. Something as simple as helping other people can go above and beyond other treatments in helping real people with depression and anxiety. So I wanted to share that story as we come to the time of January, and I don't know about you, but seasonal affective disorder is real, or seasonal affective depression, or whatever it's called. And so tomorrow, of course, you heard we'll be doing brown bag lunches. That's a good way to volunteer and to help out. Another good way is to go on the mission trip to Nashville, but there's so many things here at this church that we do volunteering and helping out in our community. And it doesn't even have to be big volunteering acts like that. The study said that some of the acts of kindness people did was just leaving an encouraging sticky note for their roommate on the door at the beginning of the day, or baking a batch of cookies to bring to their neighbor. Simple acts of kindness can help relieve depression and anxiety. Of course, we want to continue to pray for peace all over our world and continue to pray for those affected by severe weather. We especially pray for our brothers and sisters in California. We pray for the families of the 68 victims of the plane crash in Nepal. From our local congregation, please know that Harry and Sheila Noy's granddaughter, Gwen, suffered a fall last night and a brain bleed, and she's in the ICU at Toledo Hospital. So prayers for Gwen. Prayers for the family of Wally Boer, who passed away on Monday, January the 9th. Memorial service will be held this Tuesday, January the 17th, here in the sanctuary at noon. It's 12 p.m. with lunch to follow. Prayers for the family of Jean Neff, that's Denise Radenbogen's mother, who passed away yesterday, January 14th. And prayers for the family of Sharon Blows, who passed away this morning. Of course, we want to continue to pray for all of those on our prayer chain list, as well as those in military and missionary service and their families. We pray for all of those who are in transition in relationships, for those struggling with difficult financial situations, those dealing with various health issues, those who struggle with the disease of addiction and their friends and family, those who are unemployed or who have given up looking for work, all of those who are grieving, those who struggle with loneliness and depression, and all of those worldwide who continue to be persecuted and martyred for being who they are and believing as they do. If you have a prayer concern or a joy to share with us, if you're joining us online this morning, you can go to nwumc.com/connect and click on the Request a Prayer button, or leave your prayer in the comments section. And if you're here in the building, there are prayer cards located in the pews in front of you. You can fill those out and drop those in the box marked prayer on your way out of the worship service this morning. At this time, let us be still and take a deep breath. Trust that the Holy Spirit is present here in this place with us. Let us go to our God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, maker of all that is and was and ever shall be, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. From everlasting to everlasting, you are and will continue to be. Oh God, this morning we recognize that indeed you are the creator of all peoples, and that in each and every face we see, we can find your image. God, you have walked with us from before time began. You sent Jesus into our lives to be light and life to all who live, to be the real human incarnate presence of the divine among us. And for that, we give you thanks. Forgive us, God, when we make you out to be in our image, when we only hang around with those who look like us or think like us, forgetting that your people are so diverse and represent a wide spectrum of beliefs and creeds and races and languages and cultures, and that all of those taken together represent a wider picture of who you are. God, we so often fail to follow the path you have laid out before us, to listen to your calling upon our lives. Too often, God, we tend to focus on ourselves, on what we need, and our own priorities. Forgive us, Lord, when we fall into sin, when we err and make a mistake. We are only human. But give us grace, O God, and encourage us and bring us back to follow your commandments and the way of love you have laid out before us. To look not to our own needs, but to the needs of others, and to make you, above all else, the first priority in our lives. God, we are mindful this morning that there are many people throughout our world who are struggling. There are those who are grieving, God, loss of family members, friends, jobs, health, situations that we took for granted. There are people who live in violence and war who are in need of your peace. There are people, God, who are struggling with flooding and severe weather that has made life difficult. And we pray for your presence in their situations. God, there are people who are struggling in these colder winter months with loneliness and depression. We pray for them that they might know your comfort as well. God, we lift all those on our hearts and on our minds, both the names spoken out loud and those that you know. We lift these up to you, trusting that you are a God who hears our prayers and who acts decisively among them. And we give you thanks for that. We give you thanks that you are a God who is faithful and steadfast and true. We give you thanks for the love that you have shown us and continue to show us. And most of all, God, we give you thanks for the gift of Jesus into our lives, who came and showed us how to live harmoniously with one another, how to cross over to the other side, to break down barriers, and to love those who do not look like us. We join together with him now and with saints all around the world in praying the prayer that he taught us, saying as one, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
of Mark, verses 35 through 41. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And waking up, he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Be silent, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with a great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the word of God for the people of God.
I don't know about you, but one of the first television shows I ever remember watching as a child was Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. How many of you remember that show? Mr. Rogers sang to me. He talked to me about important matters that affected my life as a child. Divorce. Going to the doctor. And how I shouldn't be afraid of being pulled down the bathtub drain because I couldn't possibly fit. I took Mr. Rogers at his word because over time I had come to know him. We were neighbors. Frankly, over the years, I came to know a lot about Mr. Rogers. For instance, I knew that each time he walked into the house, he'd take off his coat, hang it up in the closet, put on a zippered cardigan, and change from dress shoes into sneakers. I knew that he fed his goldfish regularly. I knew he treated Mr. McFeely, the mail carrier, with kindness. But most of all, I knew that Mr. Rogers wanted me to be his neighbor. Not because we lived down the street from one another. He wanted to be my neighbor, to connect with me, to relate to me, regardless of where I lived. And I think he knew it would make my life better. 50 years later, I confess, I don't know my neighbors nearly as well. Yes, I know a lot of their names, especially those who live on my street. Yes, we share a limited group text, including 14 adults who share information about neighborhood activities, concern about a recent coyote spotting, major joys and needs. And I know I'm very, very lucky. My neighborhood feels safe. That being said, I don't know the name of our mail carrier. I don't know the names of those who faithfully pick up my garbage cans or recycling bins. I don't know the African-American family who lives just four houses down, their parents of young, very busy, very well-behaved toddlers. I don't know the name of the Caucasian grandmother of the neurodiverse pre-adolescent grandson who swears without ceasing and loudly uses violent, threatening language as he walks down the street. I don't know them. Nor do I know the couple who lives directly behind me. They tend to keep to themselves. I mean, I never see them walking the streets of the neighborhood. I've never seen them at a neighborhood function. I think the woman's name is Nancy. I see her on occasion in the summer watering her geraniums. We exchange hellos, but that's about it. And yet, I find myself wanting to know the neighbors in my community better, to know their stories, their hopes, and their dreams, and for them to know mine. Because I wonder if we would have more in common than I think we do. Maybe we've experienced similar traumas, tragedies, and triumphs. But let's face it, neighboring takes effort, intention. It's not something that comes easily or natural to everyone. Today we're starting a new message series called Intentional Neighboring, remembering the command of Jesus himself who said, "Love your neighbor as yourself." We're going to address the challenge of being neighbors with those who are actually more different than we are. Today's gospel reading informs that. You heard it read. And my hunch is that for many, this is a familiar story when Jesus calms the storm on a restless sea. Between us, over the years, I've preached from this story many times, talking about how Jesus is the calm in the storms of our lives. He is the ruler of all nature and the one who calls us to be still, trusting that God is always with us. But this week, I actually looked at this story a little differently. Let me provide some context. As the fourth chapter of Mark begins, Jesus is teaching beside the Sea of Galilee. He's telling stories about the kingdom of God, but such a loud crowd has gathered, he gets into a boat from which he still teaches. Then when evening comes and the sun begins to set, he asks his disciples who are in the boat with him to push off from the shore. Maybe his voice is tired. Can you imagine speaking to a crowd without amplification or microphone? Maybe he's just tired and wants a break. But regardless, he says to his disciples, "Let's cross over to the other side of the lake." Now, let me ask you, how many of you have been to Lake Tiberias, otherwise known as the Sea of Galilee? If you haven't, please know that it is deep in the Jordan Great Rift Valley, a valley caused by the separation of the African and Arabian plates. Due to its low-lying position in the valley, pop-up storms are not that unusual. But Jesus isn't bothered by that. Maybe he's just exhausted, determined to get to the other side, or maybe he knows what the Son of God can do when storms arise. For whatever reason, he falls asleep in the stern of the boat. Sure enough, a storm does kick up. Gale force winds and waves crash against the boat so that the vessel is swamped. Afraid that they are about to die, the disciples wake up Jesus. "Teacher," they say, "don't you care? We are perishing." Jesus wakes up. He gives orders to the wind and says to the lake, "Silent, be still." And sure enough, the wind and the waves obey him. There is a great calm. Then Jesus says to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" Okay, I sympathize with the disciples for several reasons. Though I love the water, I am really prone to motion sickness. Crashing waves would send my stomach overboard, if you know what I mean. Though I can swim, I could only tread water for so long. Jesus instructs them to cross the other side of the lake into new territory where the Gentiles lived, strangers beyond their own neighborhood, their own religion and experience. And I don't know about those first disciples, but I grew up with the thought of stranger danger. The whole scenario brings to me some level of fear. Jesus, I want to ask, what does this have to do with my faith? Now, let me suggest that in Mark's gospel, the movement of Jesus is now shifting. It's shifting into new territory beyond what the disciples find familiar, among people who are different and unknown. So maybe faith isn't about holding certain right beliefs, but rather trusting the presence of Jesus, who calls us intentionally into new territory with people who are like us, but also people who are different as well. Now, I know that we are often told that storms quickly arise on Lake Tiberias, but maybe the story tells us something about our fear when we go into new territory, beyond our own people, crossing over to the other side. Look, Jesus is asking the disciples to cross major geographic, cultural, and religious boundaries. Is it any wonder that a storm kicks up? Is it any wonder that things happen that will taste and test the very faith we have? I'll tell you, the first time I led a mission trip was back in 2006, when a group of six adults and four teenagers traveled across the border to Tijuana, Mexico. We were joining other groups from Ohio to work at one of the dumps there where vulnerable people try to survive, try to make a living on other people's trash. While on mission, we were there to help improve conditions and then whatever we could do to build relationships with dump dwellers, remembering though our circumstances were different, we did share a common humanity. So we were there to help and then to listen, to engage, and thankfully, a number of those we were visiting spoke our language. Because of our different skill sets, we were divided into groups, and I was a house painter. I'm no Randy Brewer either. As you may know, dump dwellers create housing out of scraps of wood, metal, whatever they can find, and it wasn't our job to judge or criticize. We were just there to enhance and help maintain what they had built. Chad, a 30-something adult with carpentry skills, was on a crew to build a community treehouse for children who lived on the dump. He and other adults were building a platform with the railing some 10 feet high in the air between trees, just above a dilapidated outhouse, lots of garbage, scraps of wood. After a few hours, I finished the shack I was painting and started my way up the dump to find another group. That's when I heard the sirens. From a distance, I saw an ambulance making its way down the rocky dirt road toward me, leaving a mountain of trash behind. Surprisingly, it stopped just about the time I recognized the woman in the passenger seat. She was from my church. Frantic, she reported, Chad and Mark fell off the platform when a board on which they were leaning gave way. They're injured. There's a head injury. They need emergency treatment. Now, Dana was used to international travel, and she always kept the group's insurance info with her in her backpack, and she was there when it all happened. All I knew was that Chad, from my church, had a head injury. He was bleeding, but stable. He was conscious, and he wanted to go back to San Diego across the border rather than to the local ER. San Diego wasn't that far away, so I slapped the hood of the ambulance and yelled, "Go!" Now, I'll tell you that story simply to acknowledge that storms are not uncommon as we cross over into new territory, reaching out to new neighbors and having to rely on Jesus for peace and calm. I also tell you that story because in retrospect, it was clear that Chad was not alone. He and Mark were among us, but they were also among other capable and faithful disciples, and we all gathered right there at the dump shortly after the ambulance took off. There were leaders and servants and common and new friends. I was included in that prayer circle. I prayed in English. Others prayed in Spanish. It didn't matter which words or which language we used. We prayed with the same intention to the very same God. And in so doing, we realized that we really weren't that different. Yes, our geography and our culture and our language were different, but in some ways, the reality of fear, the reality of pain, and our trust in Jesus, well, that was the same. Did you notice? Did you notice this often overlooked detail in this morning's story? It's right there. It's the second sentence in the 36th verse. Other boats were with them. Even though we don't see the other boats in the famous depictions of this scene, they were there as well. Those disciples were not alone. But let's make no mistake, sometimes transformation only comes in the midst of the tumult, in the midst of a storm. Let me just say that our experience in Tijuana changed a couple of us, not only because of the faith we shared in moments of great need that went beyond culture and familiarity, but because we wouldn't leave Chad alone. Other boats went with him. The following day, my whole team made its way to San Diego to the hospital. We didn't have cell service in Tijuana, so we had to wait to cross the border in order to contact the hospital and to get him discharged. A couple of us encouraged the rest of the group to go ahead, to get on the flight that was scheduled to go home. After all, it was Holy Week. Families were waiting. But the whole group decided that no one would be left behind. We came as a group. We would go home as a group. We made it to the hospital in San Diego, which is a whole story for another sermon. And we escorted a bandaged but fully alive team member in a wheelchair home. Now, I don't think that Chad's accident was a part of God's plan, any more than I think the cardiac arrest of a football player in the middle of a televised game was a part of God's plan. However, I do think that tumults, storms, provide opportunities to grow closer to one another and closer to God. Doing that in Mexico with our new friends, now that was somehow a part of God's plan. Please hear me say, I don't think God intends every storm. But I will say this, just as Jesus can calm the storm, the Lord also can use the troubled waters. Let me say that again. Just as Jesus can calm the storm, the Lord can also use the troubled waters. Because here's the truth. Transformation is almost impossible without tumult. We are not meant to stay the same or to stay within the territories that only make us comfortable. We too are being called to cross over into different neighborhoods, connecting with those who aren't exactly like us, so that we can learn to trust the real power of God and the real power of Christ. What does that look like, you ask? Well, each week in this series of messages, we're going to provide some suggestions. And some of these suggestions are very easy and doable, others not so much. The point is to be intentional about loving our neighbors as ourselves. Here are a few suggestions. If you see someone you don't immediately recognize walking a dog past your house, and you like dogs, introduce yourself. Ask about the dog as a way to start a conversation. Say hello to those who pick up your trash or deliver your mail and thank them for the work they do. Introduce yourself to those around whom you worship, if you're in the building. And if you're online, introduce or say hello to others who are there as well. Look for them next week and try to remember their names. Be intentional about having more than a passing exchange of hellos with someone you barely know. If you're an introvert and find new social encounters somewhat draining, just look a couple of people in the eye, acknowledging their presence. And then, tomorrow night, in recognition of Martin Luther King Jr. Day and our ongoing connection with Woodland Christian Church, attend worship there in a different neighborhood. If you'd like to carpool from the church parking lot, please call the church office. We'll make that happen. Look, Jesus was intentional about shifting his ministry beyond the familiar into new territory, and may we do so as well, trusting that we're not alone. Let us be more intentional about our neighboring, because sometimes it takes a little spiritual seasickness to help our trust in Jesus to grow more. Not only that, but maybe gathering across cultural lines completes the fourth chapter of Mark's gospel and gives even another image, another picture, another illustration of the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen.
Now comes the time when we as Christians prepare to respond to God's grace in our lives, in all that God has given to us, by returning our thanks and returning our gifts and our offerings back to God. So let's take this time as the ushers come forward to pass the plates, to consider how we might offer ourselves to God this week through the giving of our time and our talents and our treasure. If you're joining us online, you can give by going to nwumc.com/connect as well. Let the ushers come forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
friends. We're going to continue this series called Intentional Neighboring in weeks ahead. This week, let us challenge one another to seek other seas.